innovative technology, and if you can explain a bit what have been the barriers that you faced in this early stage of clean tech business development, and what drivers you have identified that allowed you to surpass those barriers, both from private or public support.
Okay, thank you. So I will talk about two examples. The first one will be a startup company that was basically a spin-off company developed from my research in the US at Carnegie Mellon University. I developed technology that allows to sense amount of gluten in the food. And some of you may know that celiac disease and gluten intolerance are basically quite large issues. They affect over 1% of human population globally, and there is no cure, so patients have to rely on gluten-free diet. I developed a sensor that basically allows you quite quickly and efficiently, as well as reliably, to detect how much gluten is there in the food and whether you can actually consume it or not. And you can imagine that celiac disease or gluten intolerance are not selective, and they affect both very poor people but also very rich people. So I guess this idea, because there was nothing like that on the market, attracted quite a bit of interest from wealthier patients that have celiac disease and gluten intolerance. And we actually started a spin-off company with IP from the university. But the idea, we pitched it at a few different events, and that was enough to actually attract investment. So that was mainly private investment from wealthy patients. Not only patients, there were also other potential investors interested that don't have celiac disease or gluten intolerance. But most of the investment, we got several millions USD, was from people who are affected, because simply there was a need for that. The second idea, the second example that I want to bring up is something that I'm currently working on, that I'm involved in. I'm a chief technology officer of a company called H2SG Energy. We manufacture electrolyzers, so it's like an electrochemical cell that basically you connect to electricity, you supply water, and it splits water to produce hydrogen and oxygen. This produced hydrogen, this generated hydrogen, can then be used as a clean fuel of the future. You can also use it for energy storage. There are also many different processes that actually require quite a bit of hydrogen. So in this case, that was something that was initiated by a friend of mine. And from the very beginning, I was always involved to some extent with the company. I guess he had this idea to develop a new type of electrolyzer, because electrolyzers, you can get them commercially from Siemens and other manufacturers. But the idea that we had was to develop electrolyzer that will be more efficient and cheaper, so we can actually enable this transition to clean transportation or clean energy storage. Because the price of technology was kind of main limiting factor back then. So we had this idea and we pitched it to some people in Australia, and no one was interested, because simply there is no money in Australia. Someone in Australia who you call investor will give you 50,000 Australian dollars for 20% of your equity. That's nothing. 50,000 in Australia, that's not even a salary, you know? Alex, a friend of mine who started the company, he actually went to Singapore and he pitched it to some wealthy contacts that he had through some other Singaporean contacts. One of them was a very famous businessman, billionaire, and second wealthiest person in Southeast Asia. And again, he was interested in the idea because he runs a group of companies, and he saw opportunity in basically using this energy storage opportunity in some of the hotels. So he has a network of hotels. Most of them are based in beautiful but very remote areas where basically you don't have a grid. So most of those places, imagine you are going to a paradise, but all the time you can smell diesel fumes because the place runs on a diesel generator. So that was one one issue that he wanted to solve with hydrogen. And the other one, so his other company is actually the largest polymer manufacturer in the world. And manufacturing, when you extract any type of oil, including vegetable oil, you have to process it within 24 hours. And processing involves using a lot of hydrogen. So the process, it's a simple chemical process, very well known, called hydrogenation, but it requires quite a lot of hydrogen. And if you imagine, most of those plantations, palm oil plantations, are in very remote areas of Borneo, Indonesia, as well as Brazil and elsewhere. So basically, delivering compressed hydrogen is quite costly, but it's also a logistic issue because of the remoteness of the place. So this group invested in us, initially several millions, but and that was only an idea, you know, we didn't have a prototype. It was just an idea that we need to still prove that it would be feasible. And even though they kind of liked it, so they gave us money. After 2.5 years, the money was gone. They liked the progress, so they gave us another 10 million. So we were kind of lucky that we found this not only investor, but also potential customer. We also have some other investors that have been with us from the very beginning. So another of our investors is actually another very famous businessman. He's actually Malaysian this time, but he resides in Singapore. He owns a manufacturing business, very large manufacturing business. He also has very good connections with other manufacturing businesses. He's Dato in Malaysia. So Dato is in Malaysia is like a comparable to a Sir in UK. That also helps because he has links to the government. And basically, because Malaysian government also like this idea of kind of clean energy storage, clean transportation, whatever we manufacture in our Malaysian manufacturing facility is actually tax free. So this is also benefit for a company like us, which is still growing. Our revenue is not great because we are burning through a lot of money to scale up. Our main market is actually China, because China wants to basically shift completely to a hydrogen economy. And we are currently scaling up to deliver to all the projects that we established in China. So I guess we were in a way lucky, but also we had really good investors and mentors that kind of decided to help us out because they saw need in it. And that they kind of rely on what we deliver for their own businesses. Also having a private investor, especially very experienced one, is just amazing. So every time I travel with our investors, for example to China, I return to Australia or Singapore, I just feel like I was in China for 2 weeks, but I feel like I just got an MBA, you know? Because the amount of knowledge that I get from traveling with them and visiting different customers or different potential partners, or even Chinese government, is just enormous. The learning curve is just skyrockets for me. So there are many benefits. When you have a private investor, you kind of also build a relationship with them, and you kind of, in a way, you can become friends with them. They are also more understanding towards all the issues, especially when they are involved in the business. That's amazing, because you not only get money, but this extensive network and amazing learning opportunity. So I guess in a way we were kind of lucky to find those private investors, learn from them, get their support and help.
Thank you very much, Bart.